Earth 2020. Society is in ruins, and a virus runs rampant among the world's humble citizens. They are lost. In these dark times, three wayward nerds cross paths at the House of India and realize they are destined to be friends. And so they did. This is their story. The story of The Side Quest.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Side Quest podcast. My name is Luke.
I'm BJ.
No.
Yeah.
Why?
Are you? Who are you?
Setting up everything?
Yeah.
That's not a name.
That's Matt.
Don't bully me.
So, we're starting this episode off with a little bit of story time.
Okay.
Like a week or two ago, like right after you got back from California, I got this TikTok that was like, this person is starting to hate you. And it's one of those things where they take 6 fucking minutes to draw a heart and add little fucking glitter spice and everything to it. And then they'll just draw one initial in the middle of the heart. And it was like M. And I was like, I sent it to Matt and I was like, haha, yeah, fuck you too.
I said, I'm done with your shit.
Yeah. And then ever since that day, I've gotten that exact thing done by different people with the letter M 5 times a day. And it got to the point yesterday where I was just like, what the fuck is his problem? Like a complete parasocial, like not real thing.
Like you were saying, like, what's his problem despite he's not sending them
to you? Yeah, he wasn't even privy to most of this. And so I said,
no, because he's like saying that like I hate him, and so he's like thinking I hate him.
Yeah. So I sent him the last one that I got, and I was like, you know what? Fuck you too at this point. And then immediately I went back to my For You page, and it was like, this person wants to marry you. And it's like the heart thing, and it's like M. And then I sent that one to Matt, and I was like, oh my God, I never knew. And then I got one a couple hours later that was like, this person is your soulmate. And it was an M. And I was like, our relationship has taken many steps today.
Well, it's,
we fight, we break up, we kiss, we make up.
Yeah. The line between love and hate is very blurred. Those TikToks, they always...
Look what I picked up at the gas station.
Wow.
Yeah, get a little crazy.
Get a little crazy.
A little loco, if you will.
There's only three of us, though.
I don't know why I did that.
Okay, I'm glad you didn't try to blame it on me for doing...
Well, could you imagine if he does this...
I can't believe you did that to me.
I hate you.
I taste like Code Red.
Yeah.
That's good shit.
You want to try?
Sure.
No. It went under the couch. Oh, no. It does taste like Code Red. I thought it was going to be like the Red, White, and Berry. Which I guess maybe is like Code Red, but...
How's y'all's weeks been?
Fine. I hate work.
Yeah, that's fair. How, have you officially beaten Kingdom Hearts 2, or has it been... Have you got anything else you need to do?
I beat it. There's still, like... I did all the memory fights for the organization members, but I haven't done the data ones. Because it's like, I don't want to learn all these attack patterns 13 times.
Yeah. I was going to ask if you can do all of them or just kind of be like, I did the ghost ones. And
I think I'm going to try to do all of them. And then, I'm moving on a little bit cause I'm not doing the story now, but I'll go back to it when I have time. I attempted Lingering Will. I didn't get one health bar off and I was like, damn.
Yeah. Cause I always got to imagine how, because have you seen, like, the level one critical mode, like, playthroughs of those? Where it's like, how the fuck do they do it?
Yeah, it's... That shit is crazy. I did that, and then I started playing Elden Ring again.
In preparation?
Yeah, for Erdtree. And it made me feel really good going into that cave and beating that boss that you couldn't beat on the first try.
The wolfman?
Yeah, the wolfman.
Wolf...
Harvey Wolfman.
Well, fuck you. Fuck that game. So not good. Really. I have mad respect for it. I really do.
Apparently, Erdtree's like bosses are almost borderline. Well, the final boss is like borderline unfair, because people are like, I've seen a Afrosenju, who I've shown you a couple videos from before. He is I think fought the boss over 100 times.
Goddamn.
And they're like, his videos are the funniest. He's like, it's like, I'm fucking done with Elden Ring. Moving on. It's like, round two, baby. Third video is, I'm crashing out. And like, just like that. It's just, there's parts of the videos where it's just like a 5 second boom, 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 boom. Like, you see his deaths over and over again. And he's finally just like, oh my fucking, like I love seeing that man rage at games. It's so fucking funny. But like, yeah, everybody's freaking out over that, which I don't want to, I, because of this, I know the bosses, which I won't say for you, because I don't want you to get spoiled if you haven't already, but. That I'm very excited to get to it, because I've also been playing Elden Ring a little bit, but look, it's a lot slower.
I'd like to highlight a comment on our most recent YouTube video. At Nero Falls Official, somebody said, and this is to you essentially, finally someone else who loves Dragon Age 2 made the Hawk stuff in Inquisition hit harder, being that invested in 2. Don't know what that means, but
your Hawk is the player character in 2, and they show up again in Inquisition. You can customize them again, have them be a part of the story, and then depending on your choices, they can die.
Okay.
Like sacrifice themselves, and it's like, oh shit, because yeah, you went through the whole story for them, and then seeing in Inquisition, it's like, oh shit, they could theoretically, like, you could give them a honestly pretty satisfying ending of sacrificing themselves for their loved ones kind of vibe, and it's like, oh shit, and then depending on if they had a romantic partner or not, or who it was, Varric, the dwarf of Inquisition, who's also Hawk's like best friend, will be like, I have to go like write notes to them, and I'm not looking forward to that kind of shit. So it's actually really fucking cool because of it.
So in summation, thank you for the comment, but we really don't need anyone glazing Luke's opinions. Yeah, so please stop.
100%.
Hey, well, keep it going.
Yeah.
Bro.
Yeah.
Validate my shit.
Yeah, I'm also not excited to hear your opinion about season 2 of Dungeons and Daddies.
We'll get into it. Don't worry about it.
This is the time to get into it.
I had two things that I want to talk before we get into Dungeons. First of all, was I'm playing Elden Ring. It's good.
We both have the same reaction. Both...
Yeah.
Oh god.
I'm
go slowly ahead and talk about Valhalla again.
Elden Ring. I'm going slower because I'm actually like looking up builds. I'm like, I'm gonna try to like, instead of what I did the first Elden Ring, which big was like, sword. I don't know, kind of go with, like, yeah, because I just went, like, big sword, strength, whatever. I'm trying a dex thing, which everybody says is, like, broken in all these games, so I'm going to try it. I start with Samurai, and I'm going through that. I beat, which should have just, started that way, because I beat fucking, who the fuck, first boss, Molag, the first one, on the little bridge area.
Margit,
yeah. Fucking wrecked his shit in 3 tries. I was like, hell yeah, dude. Whereas before, that shit took me, like, 25 plus.
I haven't even been to Stormvale yet. My first mission is always go get the fucking great sword.
Yeah. Get Guts sword and then be like, all right, now I can actually play the game.
Yeah, start pouring points into strength.
But yeah, so I've started that. And then I texted BG about this, and it's my least favorite part about any video game is when they push you off the path to be like, hey, here's the story. Anyway, no, go back and collect a bunch of shit. I'm like, that's fucking stupid and I hate it. But this happened in the game I'm playing now, which is BioShock. I just said,
finally.
Fuck it.
Whoa.
Well, because I texted you guys, like, then I was like, hey, I need games to play. I don't know what to play. And, like, I didn't get an answer, so I was like, ah, they're probably busy. And so then I'm like, I don't know what I want to play. And I just kept scrolling through my shit, and I still saw BioShock. I'm like, yeah, Matt and BJ told me to keep playing this. And so I said, fuck it. So I've gotten to the point where
would recommend, even though you're already into it, but to other people who, like, could get through all 3, I would recommend, even though it's hard because 3 is the best, but it's so much better going through 1 after knowing the knowledge of 3.
My suggestion is go through 1 and then immediately jump to 3. 2 is made by a different studio, and overall, after playing 3, it really doesn't matter.
But I will say 2 is fun because you get to play as Big Daddy.
Yeah, I mean, that's cool.
That's super cool.
The vibes I
say PlayStation All-Stars is fun because I get to play as a Big Daddy.
That is, yeah. I think the vibe that I've seen is that 2 has, like, the best atmosphere because of the Big Daddy shit, and, like, your character is hindered because of that, because you're limited to what a Big Daddy can do.
But also, 3 does the Big Daddy thing even better, in my opinion.
Huh.
I liked 2 for what it was. I thought it was thematic. It's obviously same universe, but they were like, now you get to play as the person that you were like deathly afraid of in 1.
I mean, I'm not saying that it's bad. It's just a different vibe.
For sure. But I liked when I played 3 being like, oh shit, this is all like, it's all lore drops for 1. And it leads to 1.
See, yeah. I am more excited to play in the order of go 1, 2, 3 because
that's great.
Mostly because I can already tell I'm gonna, if I had played 1 like Infinite first, I would hate Bioshock.
And to get your point, to like agree with your point, is I also would be like, let me just skip the bullshit and play the best one first.
Yeah, yeah. Like, well, already it's very small things, but Bioshock 1 is absolutely a game that came out in 2007. And it shows.
Yeah.
And even though
a remaster of it?
Yeah, I'm playing the collection, which are like upscaled, higher frame rates, better textures, but they play the same.
Yeah.
And so you can tell it's like just the way like the game just kind of plays itself. It also has my least favorite thing in some of these early first person shooters where your player character technically has a voice actor in the beginning cutscene, but then never speaks the whole fucking game. Despite the fact that characters will constantly talk to you or at you and things like that, and then
well, in the end, you'll realize that you actually really liked that.
Maybe, but like it's like I love the Metro series, but it's literally my least favorite part there too, where RTM will talk in the beginning cutscene and in loading screens to tell you what he thinks about what just happened, but not to the characters, and so they'll be like, "Isn't that right, RTM? I knew I could count on you," and I'm like, "I didn't say fucking shit." Half-Life 2 does this worse, where Half-Life 1 is good because you are just kind of an insert. But then Half-Life 2, everybody's like, no, you're what's his name, Morgan? Or Freeman?
Morgan Freeman.
Yeah, I don't know. I haven't played Half-Life 2 in a while. But you, like everybody will talk to this character like he's the fucking shit, which he is after 1. But like it now makes him more of a character, less of, oh, this is just the player vessel. So, yeah. But, yeah, I'm at the fucking botanical garden shit. Andrew Ryan... that's the name, yeah, I think. He fucking killed the scientist lady and she like scrawled her code on the wall.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, oh, that's cool.
The theory about the in 3, the twins.
The theory.
Who they are.
I mean, they kind of explain it in 3, don't they?
Yeah, I guess so. I think though a lot of people don't pick up on it though.
Yeah, I mean, if you're not going for, like, the audio logs, then what the fuck are you doing in Bioshock?
I agree, but it's not, like, story, like, it's...
Yeah, it's not, like, part of the main plot.
Even though they're very important people.
Most important.
Yes, exactly. Okay.
Did you guys play the DLC for Infinite as well? Like, Barrel at Sea?
I played the first episode.
Because apparently those are, like, massively important, aren't they, as well?
Yeah.
One didn't have DLC, right? I think, unless it's like challenge levels.
I think they had challenge levels, but those are all included in the collection.
Because I was wondering, I'm like, do I have to like play anything extra? Because I think 2 has multiplayer and some other thing.
Yeah, 1 and 2, I think both have no story DLC. Okay.
What I do really like about the whole series is they give you all these powers, and it's not like in a lot of games where like, here's a power, and this power you have to use for this thing. It's like, if you like a power, you can
use
just...
it for the whole fucking game.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Like, I think there are a couple, like, electricity is good against, like, a couple things, or it doesn't affect. But, like, other than that, it's not like, oh, yeah, like, you need this to get through this wall, and you need this to defeat this kind of enemy, because it's the only thing that works against this enemy. So you have to wait until you get that up, that, you know, what is it called? The...
Vigor.
Vigors. Yeah.
What'd you call me?
I knew somebody was going to say that.
We should bleep out the first part of it.
Yeah, just the VI.
Yeah. I really like that. I like that it really, it's not like, yeah, like well, the traditional thing where it's like...
They do a good job of putting something in your way that is for that. Like, when you get the telekinesis, there's a fucking tennis ball launcher to be like, hey, try it. But, like, it's not required for, like, the thing. Or, like, well, there is the one bit where, like, the guy, to get telekinesis, you have to backtrack. But, like, every other one, it's like, you can go find fire. You don't need it. You can literally skip getting the flame.
Well, I mean, like, I get, like, you progressively get them in story, but, like, you on it's not, like, one of those things.
It's never a requirement to where it's like, hey, this wall can only be broken by using the ice thing or whatever.
Yeah. It's like, it's one enemy, It's like, if I just like one vigor, I could just keep it equipped and I don't have to like switch it out in mid battle because this is the only thing that's good against an enemy is this type.
I also love that I guess I got lucky or the game bugged, because I remember playing it the first time back in, which my last save file for this game was 2018. That's how long it was when I played it last.
Damn.
And I played it, and I remember the Big Daddy walking around in that room the first time. You have to like walk past them and like not get seen or whatever, or like just, hey, don't fuck with them. And it's because, like, and, you know, what's his face, Atticus or whoever the blonde haired dude is, like, hey,
Atlas.
He's like, don't want to run into those guys. And then you go through the whole thing, and you know, you get your powers and fight him later. This time, I guess my game bugged. He just didn't show up. So I'm just running through this level, nobody's business. Be like, where are those fuckers?
That's like the first time I played New Vegas, and I walked through the quarry, and there were just no death claws.
Yeah, and so finally, when it's like, when I walked back in the room after getting all the powers, like the game is like, all right, you need to have these to get past. They're like, hey, you can now fight the Big Daddy. I'm like, where is he? And then all of a sudden, just around the corner, he's there. I'm like, oh, hey, what's up? And now
jumps down from the rafters and crushes your spine.
Now it's like on sight. Like, I don't care who it is. I don't care who they are. I am murking them like nobody's business. Like, I'll see them and I'm like, I can take them. Like, so I just get the shotgun, electricity. I found the Big Daddies that like will throw the bombs at you, so I'm using telekinesis. I'm dude, left and right, no hesitation.
Did you use in 3 the crow power?
I love the crow power.
That's the best one.
I was gonna say, I just keep that and the magnum for the whole fucking game.
100% crows for life.
Crows for life.
Two crows.
Two crows.
I've been Luke rocking and two the crows. Immediately. So, did you guys harvest or save the little girls?
Save the little girls.
Yeah, I've been saving them all, which I feel like gets it you also, more than it, enough it, anyway. Because the more you save them, a homegirl will just give you like Adam anyway.
Yeah, I looked it up once. It's very negligible.
Yeah,
if you.
Really, because all you have to do is find...
It's just fucking fucked up. Like, that's the only difference is you get a fucked up ending.
You want to kill this little girl for almost nothing?
Yeah, it's so, like, you get no benefits, so, like, and you're just like, ha-ha!
But, see, that's, like, the other great thing about, too, is, like, there's all these stuff that you go through, and you're like, oh, like, now I gotta protect him, and you face off, like, different enemies, like the Big Sisters, those things.
See,
freaky
two
bitches.
Two, everything I've read about them, because, like, I was, like, Googling while, you know, I was, like, getting the game ready or whatever, and I was like, okay, so one is, like, a really good first step. 3 is the fucking best one, where it's all amazing. 2 is, like, the actual more horror one.
Yeah.
Where like, 1 kind of starts that way, but you very quickly can kind of get powerful, and it kind of becomes negligent, where, like, you're like, oh, like, because they'll be talking through the walls, and you're like, I don't give a fuck, get out here. Whereas I feel it
but
seems
there
like...
is one fun thing about 2, which is, I mentioned it, that you're, like, now playing the thing that you used to be, like, scared of in the first game, and I think that also lends, it's, like... 2 is definitely more like scary, but the fact that you're like, no man, like I'm the boss, like I'm a boss in this game, like I'm Big Daddy, like I can kind of like I can take on these fuckers.
How long?
Get that drill going.
My thought process in real life.
Yeah.
How long do I have left in this? I'm pretty sure I have a while, but I just like I said, I Atlas's wife and kid died in the submarine because Andrew Ryan blew it up, and then I went, and now he's like, we're taking it to him. And I'm now in like this is the botanical gardens, having to go back and find like, you had to find 7 things of distilled water and 7 chlorophyll vials and then 7 bee essence. And I'm like, oh, fuck. So I'm doing that. Like how,
I don't think you have too much longer, but
the game moves relatively fast. I will give it that.
Yeah,
with
the
exception of what I'm doing now. Everything else has gone, like, very quickly. And that's the only, like, I stopped playing last night because I'm like, fuck, I don't want to fucking... Because we talked about it, like, with Sonic Heroes, where it's like, here's all these fast stages of this. Right now, playing as Vector in them, you got to find shit.
Yeah, you got to search for hermit crabs on the ground.
And I'm like, I hate when games will do that, where it's like...
Changes the pace.
Yeah, because because so far, like, I've been going through BioShock with, like, oh, this is great, listen to the audio logs, do the thing. And then immediately it's like... Okay, and I get it, for the story it works, but I feel like you could have just lessened what I have to get, and like, I don't know, like, cause...
I think the reason that they do that is because they change the map at some point, and they just want you to go back and look at it.
Okay, yeah, fair.
Because there's one point where it's like, oh, all these barricades and turrets get put up, and there's way more graffiti and dead bodies.
Well, because I do know that they did kind of push me towards the, like, the B spot, which is on a separate map, area, so I get that, but it is a thing where I'm like, dude, I was right there. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know. So it is annoying, but all in all, I do like BioShock 1, and I'm very interested to get to Infinite. And I think It'll be easier because, like, I from what I can gather, it seems these games aren't as long. It's about the same length as like a Mass Effect game. So I can probably get through this trilogy within like the month.
I was gonna inject some BioShock into Cyberpunk, but we didn't have enough time that night, so I'm just saving that lore for later.
That is, I mean, this is nothing against you. I just kind of wish there was like more. I mean, we'll have more, and that's it. I just wanted more.
Yeah.
I'm very interested because like
especially with what you can do in like traditional just TTRPG campaigns is like, what do you guys want to do? And it's like, oh, like, you know, like coming up with finding just random quests, or like me saying like, I want to open up a PI, a private investigator, you know, thing with a LOFA, like all that kind of stuff was like, oh, it was just getting good.
Yeah. To be fair, there was a point where like, I think it worked cause you pulled the rug out from under us, but like you were setting up like what, like, season 2 would have been for our characters.
Yeah, and that's what I was like super jazzed for.
You are
like, we're in Night City.
You are going back.
Yeah, I know.
Whenever we get bored of D&D.
Well, that's the thing. It's like, I'm sure that we'll play some stuff and we'll be hooked and we'll be into it. And it's like, then I'm gonna want that to go on for a while.
Yeah, because I already know how you guys are gonna get back. Whoa. If indeed you do end up going back.
I can already see it now. He's like, all right, see, we're taking a submarine down. How did D&D get a submarine? Shut up. Anyway, Cthulhu's
Artificers,
here.
Dude.
Yeah, well, no, and he goes, anyway, we're now going into Call of Cthulhu because you've unleashed an Eldritch Horror, and now next week, get new dice, new character sheets.
Like, see, I wouldn't be mad about that.
We just multiverse jump through fucking TTRPGs.
Yeah, I mean,
wouldn't be mad about that at all.
That has kind of been my plan, is to just find a bunch of different, like, games. Like, I really want to do that Western one where you have to use the cards. I think that would be fun.
I'd be very interested in doing Vampire the Masquerade.
That one's right up your alley.
Well, that one seems like just fucked. Like D&D is like the adventure of the crew. Cyberpunk is kind of also, but like Vampire the Masquerade is like, it is you, yourself, and that's it. Look out for number one. Fuck everybody else. And like, apparently, like, team killing is just super viable in Vampire the Masquerade, where it's like, no, yeah, you want to do that. And I'm like, what the fuck? Why? Probably wouldn't work out as well because we only have two of us. Yeah. To really, like, oh, you know? But, like, I was reading a thing where
I would actually, yeah, if you killed my character, I would actually kill you.
Yeah. Like, there was a, one of the perks was that this person was talking
don't
about.
Don't come over next Tuesday.
One of the perks in Vampire the Masquerade is you can move your heart to a different part of your body. And so, like, if someone tries to stake your character's heart, you can play dead. And it'd be like, oh, yeah, they died. And then, like, use that and, like, be like, oh, no, what the fuck? Like, you can actually, like, work with that. So I'm like, that's a weird fucking system.
If we do Vampire the Masquerade, it is 100% just going to be what we do in the Shadows references.
100%. I figured if we did it, it would just, we're doing what we do in the Shadows, where it's more goofy and fun than it is, like,
everyday life.
Yeah, just every...
You get a spam email. We've been cursed! Fuck!
It's just two vampire roommates just to be like,
I think that's the funniest, like the most I've laughed at a TV show ever.
Yeah. The Jackie Daytona one is still my favorite episode. That and the Nandor De Laurentiis.
Oh yeah, because that one's so chaotic. And
Jackie Daytona's when he
Yeah, he like goes undercover to avoid Mark Hamill.
Yeah, that shit was, I was dying.
The episode that I laughed so hard is he gets, Nandor like finally opens up his email. And he has, like, 1,000 unread emails. And he's going through them. He goes, like, Bloody Mary has cursed you. You need to send this to 50 people or you will die before, like, dawn. And they're like, fuck, fuck. And then so Guillermo's with the vamp trying to find virgins to sacrifice. So he finds vampire hunters. And they're like, he thinks they're going to their house. And so then they're all, everyone in the house is freaking out about the Bloody Mary curse. And so Guillermo calls the house to warn them that they're coming.
Yeah, the vampire hunting group wants to go to this house in Staten Island where vampires live. And he's in the van and he goes, get out of the house! You're gonna die tonight!
And they all just start...
Like, it's fucking Bloody Mary.
I fucking love that show.
God.
It's amazing. That next season is gonna be so sad at the end.
It's gonna be so sad. I'm glad you got me into that because, like, I actually went back and watched because it's like
he wrote me into this.
Okay, so yeah, you getting him and then getting to me, it was great because yeah, that show is so fucking hilarious.
Yeah, it's incredible.
But yeah, I like Bioshock, and once I get past this shitty go collect 1,400 things, and I'll continue on, and I'll text you guys more, because I refrained from texting about it, because I was like, I want to talk on the podcast. I think it'd be a fun little, like, oh, here, let's talk
so you
on the podcast.
BG, though?
Well, I vaguely texted him, because I feel like, I don't know.
I've been playing a game that starts with B and ends with shock.
It starts with B and ends with uck.
Bach.
No, I was Bach, just, Beethoven. I pretty much was just like, Because I wanted to rant. I feel like I rant with BJ about, like, game mechanics and shit all the time, so I didn't feel out of place. Where I was just like, bro, I fucking hate when the pacing breaks and you just becomes a collect-a-thon and shit. And then immediately we started talking about Sonic the Hedgehog after that. Because, yeah, of course it always comes back to that.
Yeah.
Either that or Kingdom Hearts for us.
But Kingdom Hearts doesn't make you do that shit.
That is true, and it's great.
One did.
It doesn't make you.
It doesn't make you.
It's
that
an
was
optional,
all optional
thing that you can do. You can go through those games just by the story, and you'll be
fine. The problem is that they gave me the option.
All right, now fuck you, Luke. Tell us what you think about season two.
So I think it's fine. That's it.
Do.
I have. It's not better than season one. But
is
like
it worse? Do you think it's worse?
Objectively, yeah.
Okay.
But like, it's when I say worse, it's like if I rated it, it's like season one is like 9 out of 10. Great. I had some like, pretty much whenever they got. I feel like season one. Story-wise, was pretty much went all up, but like after a while, like even some of those last episodes, I was definitely even listening. I was just kind of bored in some areas because I'm like, okay, I get like, you know, get to Willy. Like I want to see you kill him. I want to see the final battle. And like there was like a 4-episode stretch of just preparing, which had some great moments. Like the goblin joke was still the highlight. Mm-hmm. There are moments where I'm like, all right,
we got a goblin army.
Yeah. and then But, like, all in all, I would say it's, like, 8 out of 10, whereas, like, I feel like this is, like, a 6. So far, at least. But I've learned, though, through it, because before I started Season 2, I went and listened to the prequel series, the On Mountains of Dadness or whatever.
Yeah, that's a good episode. Yeah,
that's a great episode.
Oh, you see that episode? I would listen to the whole prequel series. It's, like, a 5-session thing.
Yeah.
Or, yeah. Great. Awesome.
Well, I only listened to the first one because that was the only one that was on Spotify.
Yeah, it is. It's really good. And they also have another. Before season three, they did another Call of Cthulhu one. And they did like a murder mystery one. They have one with the Star Wars TTRPG, which is the title of the campaign is called. It's a 4-episode thing. It's All That Jizz, yeah. In reference to the fucking jizz. Music. Yeah. But like, I've learned before starting, and that's probably helped with season two, because I feel like if I would have started season two immediately after, I probably would have been more like you guys, where I'm like, yeah, it's not as good, whatever, it's not this. But like, I started listening to the post show, like once I subscribed to the Patreon, I started listening to post show stuff for season one after an episode or two. I kind of just got to the point where like I just enjoy Matt, Will, Freddy, Beth, and Anthony. Like I don't care what they're doing at this point. It's more of, because my favorite parts in all of this has just been when they start going off on a tangent, or like when Anthony will fucking yell at them, be like, no, that's not how this is. Fuck you. Like that, which happened already within 2 episodes of season two, where Matt and Anthony just yelled at each other.
Here's the thing, though. Like, you're wrong. Because season three is going to be a 9 out of 10.
Season three is incredible.
It's
already.
So it's like it's right back. And that's like the stark difference to me is what like. To me, like, really, really reinforced that season two was just, like, not it.
Yeah.
And you can like whatever you like.
You can cancel me for that. See if I care. I don't think you should be on this freaking game if you don't have a mic. Cancel me. Go ahead and cancel me.
I don't know. I've just never been on that thing where I'm like.
Well, how many episodes are you in?
5.
I think that's right around where I stopped.
My favorite one just happened with 4 with Elise. Where I was like, where she just came in just to be the fucking popular girl who lost her teeth.
Yeah.
Because of Lou Bega and Mambo number 5 mm-hmm. trying to weird science his girlfriend of the prom.
Did you get and, to the... I think I must have listened to an episode or two past 5 because...
Because the dance is, or at least, I don't know if the dance is episode 5 or the next one, but they're I like on the way up here, I just got to the point where...
I'm 2 episodes past the dance, I think.
Okay, so yeah. I've only gotten spoiled on one thing just due to me like looking up like reviews of season two, because like the way you guys talked about it was like it's the fucking worst thing ever, and I'm like I feel like it wouldn't have gone on 50 some episodes if it was that bad. That's a me thing, but the one thing is at some point I know Willy comes back, and my guess is that he's the patron of Beth's character's like warlock powers, So that's my, and then it helps, you know, she's in the Stampler line technically by stepdad logic. So I'm like, yeah. All right, cool. He'll probably make it work. So that's the only thing that I'm like, I think I got spoiled on, possibly, at least theory wise. I know he's coming back at some point, but yeah, I don't know the general vibe. And I do know that Scary will betray the group at some point. Those are the only two things that I know about season two.
Well, isn't that because of the like future reading?
I haven't gotten to the future reading yet, so I don't know about that. I don't think. So yeah, but I mean, in general, like, I don't know. It's not bad enough that I want to stop and immediately skip to season three. At least
they
where I
just
I'm at.
Put out a new episode today.
Hell yeah! Can't wait to listen to that.
They it's just like I think it's called like We Made a Car, something like that. No, yeah, last episode of season three was so good.
Yeah, it was hilarious.
Hysterical.
Yeah, and then all the stuff that's going on with Beth's character. Wild.
Yeah, that was kind of creepy what Anthony did.
Yeah.
I didn't know if her character was going to survive. But it leaves what's great about her character is it leaves the ability for her character to die.
Mm-hmm.
You get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I love no context spoilers because it just makes it more fun. I'm like, what the fuck are they talking about?
Because it's very creative. It's
you guys literally did it all...
Technically, Beth's character could die as many times as
possible.
Yeah.
Technically. Oh, okay. Technically. That's interesting. Yeah, how's Will's DMing? Because I've been
incredible. It's so fun because in last episode, Anthony said. Now you
see how it feels, motherfucker.
Yeah, and I was like, oh my gosh, they're putting fucking Will through the ringer, including Anthony. Where Anthony
for that whole fucking episode,
him under the bed.
Yeah,
he was just like, no.
Yeah, I'm not gonna do anything.
Yeah.
He's like, are you sure? Like, do you fall asleep? Maybe do you snore?
He's like, roll for snore.
Nope,
I don't snore.
That bit, like what you're talking, that's like my favorite thing about this. And it's like that's happened in every single campaign bit that I've had, where it's the one shots, season one or season two. And my favorite like them arguing bit was Freddy trying to roll a charisma roll and goes, oh, this is how it feels to be you guys, because he has no bonuses. And then immediately, like, you can tell.
Is the shit Anthony, in the car when they're escaping the underground?
I don't think I've gotten there. Well, underground.
The underground layer with the FBI?
I'm about to get to that, I think, then.
Then I must have listened to like 10 episodes.
You got further then, yeah. Because
I must have listened to a lot.
They did something out of order because what was originally just a joke thing, because Lincoln, Matt's character, wrote the police officers like notes being like, hey, I feel really bad about this. And then it ends.
He calls the police.
Well, it ends with the FBI going, do you know about this? And he goes, yeah, like a week later, this happened. And then they went, all right, anyway, back to this. And then just now it's like, yeah, you got visited by the FBI. And Matt had to lie because he's like, yeah, did y'all get visited? Because I didn't.
Oh,
there's
a whole underground bunker.
Yeah, I haven't gotten
car chase and all a bunch of bullshit happens.
I haven't gotten
also,
to that
also, it's
yet.
A whole thing, though, that I don't really like about this season, I didn't like about last, which is essentially what I like about pure D&D, is it's like, oh, fuck, like, you beat my boss somehow on a strength check. Like, all right, like, this is, I have to roll it. Like, this is,
yeah.
Like, this is what happens now. And it's Anthony would be like, yeah, he grabs you again. Like, no, you're like, no, that's not how it works.
You
can't just say no.
So yeah. Far, there hasn't been a lot of that.
But there's also been no combat. The combat is so basic. It's
God, I wish that was me. I wish I could just sit in a room and roleplay for 12 hours a day.
The biggest thing, because they've combated against the speedrunning bitch slightly, but then they had to do the speedrun bit, which I died laughing because fucking Freddy couldn't do the lottery bit because he has no charisma, and so he kept trying to convince his mom. He's like, no, let's get these lottery numbers, and he just kept resetting
yeah.
the time loop. And then Beth gets it just by like, oh yeah, I got in a Tesla accident and then made a fucking Billie Eilish song and became a fucking millionaire by 17.
That's the song that she sings.
No, because the one she sang at the show was like a rock song. This is the one in this one was called Lizard Slut.
Oh, okay.
And it was like, it was literally just a Billie Eilish like goofy shit, which immediately.
No, they do something with Taylor Swift or a song. Anyways, and that's. It has to do with the song. That
yeah, they so far all again the intros are on point too. Like all the music stuff. Will Campos did the thrift shop remix for pissing in urethras and what was it, urology class?
Yeah, it's
that's and that's the thing. A lot of the shit that, like, I don't know. I'm just enjoying now, like, the people. Like, I don't, at this point, because I've listened to a lot of their shit, I don't care who they're playing, because, like, I'm more interested in just, like, how are you gonna fucking do this? And then, like, hear them go off about it. Because I'm also listening to, like the post shows for season two as well. I'd probably way further if I didn't do that, but I'm listening, like, half of it until they get to listener questions, and I'm like, all right, I don't care. I just want to hear their reactions to shit. And their biggest thing they, because I think I can understand why you dipped out immediately, and you probably don't want to continue on, because I think they apparently, the first three episodes were all done in, like, a batch recording of, like, where they kind of were still figuring out their characters, and by episode four onward, they kind of have a better grasp, because they're like, okay, we kind of get it, because the first three episodes were, like, done, like, in a weird order, at least filming-wise, and so, like, now Freddy has a voice for his character when, like, the first episode he didn't. But, like, now he's kind of going in on, like, the, yeah, anime nerd voice. Whereas before, he was just doing Freddy.
There is one thing, I don't think you've gotten to it, but has he gotten the sword yet?
No, but Beth got the masturbation knife.
Okay.
Well, then so I haven't gotten a sword yet.
Well,
I got a couple of those.
The, Freddy's character gets a katana.
He got a cane sword from his house, but that's all he has.
He gets a katana and he goes, I can't even remember the name, but it's the he's like, is this a Hattori Hanzo seal? And that killed me.
He's made the Hattori Hanzo joke already, because he has
the mall.
Well, he's got the cane sword, and he literally went he did the thing where he, like, unsheathed it and looked at it like my mentor Hattori Hanzo. I was just like, fuck.
No,
off.
Yeah, he gets his sword and he goes, is this Hattori Hanzo steel?
Yeah,
and then he's like, I would know if it is. Because I would go to the mall.
Yeah, the mall katana shit.
I would look at mall katanas all the goddamn time.
So far, he
has the best characters.
His and Lincoln's are my favorite. I fucking hate Normal Oak. He's the most annoying one.
Yeah. With his sweaty mascot.
Well, because the fucking immediately,
he throws,
like,
up in it.
Immediately, I'm just like, you're disgusting. Like, Henry was, like, gross in a fun way, whereas, like, Normal's just,
yeah, he would eat bugs
fucking
and
gross
and have, like, dirty feet.
Like, yeah. Like, he's just gross, and I'm like, I don't like him. Beth's, like, annoying, but, like, that's the point. She's being a pick-me, like, I don't want attention, but secretly I do, like, pick-me girl shit. Which, even her, like, the post-show after episode three, she's like, God, I hate her character, but, like, I love hating her character, because it's like, I'm literally having to be everything that I hate, and it's such a weird thing to try and do, and I'm like, that's cool. But, yeah, Taylor and Lincoln are my two favorites, and just because Lincoln is such a deviation from Daryl.
Do you guys want to talk about your D&D characters you created?
I do, actually.
All right, go ahead, Shadow the Hedgehog.
All right, so my character is shit.
Don't reveal too much.
No, I'm not going to reveal, like, all the backstory shit, because there's some stuff that me and him worked out that I'm like, oh, this will be cool reveals. But I'm playing a half drow, or half elf if you go by D&D Beyond, because we don't have the drow characteristic shit. Half drow, who is... named Ravis, who is searching for his mother. He's a warlock, and I'm trying to, like, explain this without giving away too much, because I want stuff to, like, naturally come out on the play session too. But yeah, basically he you know, grew up with his dad, who's a human, and his mom just kind of disappeared one day. And now he's kind of just trying to search for, made a deal with a demon, and, doesn't know if he can go home or not yet. He's in this weird, like, you know, just, I don't think I can go home yet. And so he's both searching for his mom and also kind of, like, trying to come to terms with what he has done. But yeah, that's kind of where I'm at.
Sorry.
I mean, I don't, like, I'm trying to, like, because a lot of the stuff I talk with BJ is, like, very important story shit that, like, oh, this might, like, affect what he has planned and shit, so I don't know.
Yeah.
But, yeah, so, searching for my mom, he's gonna be, I still don't know exactly how I'm playing him, and I kind of want it to, as we go on, go, but, like, I picked another character with higher charisma stats. But I don't want to do...
Do you not want to do the role-playing?
Well, I do, but it's more like I don't want to do the, because like I'm gonna try to, like, again, I'm not a charismatic person, so that's the downside of, like, yeah, it's like, be charismatic. And I'm like, yeah.
Well, thankfully, I am also charismatic, yeah. And I will also roleplay charismatic.
Yeah, yeah, I'm gonna try to be the more, like,
dark and brooding.
Well, no.
yes.
No, I intentionally, my character is not, like, depressed and, like,
ugh. You did ask me for a demon orb.
Yeah, well, that's just aesthetic, right?
You're not getting it.
Okay.
I'm gonna give it to somebody else.
Okay. And?
I just want to make you jealous.
I won't. I'll think it's the coolest shit, and they're gonna be my favorite character in the campaign.
And then I kill them.
Who I'm planning on giving it to, you will think it's the coolest shit ever.
Yeah, no, dude, trust, like, again, I don't know why I like it. Prosthetics, demon arm, whatever the fuck, just that shit, like...
Luke be sitting awake in bed thinking, God, I wish I was disabled.
I don't know, man. Like, when I was playing fucking Metal Gear 5, just him having the red, like, even though it was, like, a very dinky, like, arm, I was like, that's fucking cool. I don't know why I think, like, aesthetically it's, like, the coolest shit ever. It's also with, like, armor. Like, I've saw, like, armor sets where it's, like, one arm, like, it's, like, just a leather thing within the right one. It's, like, a full metal gauntlet with, like, powers and shit. Just that offset of it is cool for me. But, yeah, no, I want to play my character more of just, like... Not dark and brooding, but more like he doesn't really know what to, like, he's confused, he doesn't know what to do.
Yeah, sexually.
He has to deal with this demon thing.
You'll sort that out.
You're the bard, you're planning to probably sleep with everybody, right?
Well, I can introduce my character. My character, and I thought a lot about today. A lot about, and this is good. And also, like, I love you. I know, oh boy. This is weird. Well, hold on. There's also, like, BJ needs it one night, or it was like an afternoon, actually.
Yeah.
I was on my computer and BJ comes out and he goes, like, hey man, like, I love you. I was like, yeah, like, I love you too. Like, I got you, but, like, this is not you.
I could see the look on his face, like, what's wrong?
Yeah, 100%. Like, obviously, like, there's love. Like, I got you. That's not you. What's, like, what the fuck is happening? And he said,
I had a dream that Matt died, and he died at the front of the dream, and then the, like, most of the dream was just me dealing with the aftermath of Matt dying.
Oh fuck.
I know. And I was like,
and that was a Tuesday night that I had that dream.
And so I was like fair, like, I've had lots of fucking fucked up dead dad dreams, so, like, I get how kind of, like, how that,
yeah, okay, like, cause you in your head you live through it and then you wake up and you're like, fuck.
Yeah, no, yeah. Like, so, like, I was like, fuck, man, like, I'm sorry, like, I'm here and I got you and I love you too. But anyways,
dies,
I love BJ, and I think I also trust BJ immensely with this game, and so I'm leaving a lot for to go along the ride in my character. But what I've determined today is my character does not have a name, which makes sense.
It really does.
It really does.
I'm very interested.
I do not.
That.
My okay. Character does. Or I don't know my name.
Ooh, okay.
That's not too spoilery.
Are you going? Do you have, like, a moniker to be called at the moment, or no?
I mean, I could tell you. This is basic stuff that when we, like, meet each other, but, yeah. Like, when our characters meet, I'll just say, like, every, you know, I'll just, like, every town I go to, I come up with a new name, or, like, a letter of the alphabet, kind of. You know,
yeah.
I'm like, yeah, you know, H or K or
he, M. We get to a town, he calls himself H, and he goes, oh, that's weird. It's, yeah, like deja vu.
That feels right.
Yeah,
that feels right.
I don't have a name. I am a bard, a College of Lore bard.
What does College of Lore do, or is it just kind of...
They watch YouTube videos. 3-hour long video essays, yeah, on lore.
I know a lot about Kingdom Hearts. And Resident Evil and Final Fantasy.
Sounds right. Very familiar.
Hey, and up? What's up, bro? I have a lute that I play.
Give me the lute.
And I am also, I'm a half elf. I'm unusually tall for a half elf, which also means I'm just unusually tall.
Yeah.
I was going to say, aren't they, like, generally, like, normal proportions?
Yeah, just regular people.
Yeah, but I'm unusually tall.
It's like in the Baldur's Gate character creator where you just, like, body size, like, 3, where you're just fucking
I have
beefed
some
up.
Aesthetic inspirations. One of being kind of like the build of the rooster in Robin Hood, the Disney Robin Hood, with kind of the hat and the face of the apostle archer in Griffith's army. That little like pointy hat.
Yeah.
With the one feather.
Yeah. So Matt's inspirations are Berserk and Disney's Robin Hood.
Yes. And that's
two about, polar opposite that's, sides of the fence.
Furry awakening versus like existential crisis.
And
I mean, that is an existential crisis.
That's as much as I'm willing to to like say to you.
That's fair.
Right now, I think the rest is going to be there's a lot of it's up to BJ, but there is some stuff that I'm hiding from you because I think it'd be fun for you to. Yeah.
Well, like,
either roll well on something or figure out by yourself.
I'm more interested because there's things that like me and BJ kind of like fucked with of like, oh, this will be fun. And like, I'm very interested in how that will show up in the story. Because like, I basically gave him free ammo of here's quests you can make us do with my character. Mm-hmm. And then like, obviously like backstory stuff of like,
I have plenty of ideas of backstory for me that I'd
I've got a fun idea.
Like to drop on BJ to be like, this would be a really fun idea for the actual backstory of my character. But then I'm thinking like, what if I'd be like, cause I know BJ's got us, you know? Like,
yeah.
Like that's what I like truly know. Cause dope shit happened, especially with all the fucking like things we love that he integrated into Cyberpunk. That's like,
so while we're sitting here,
it's live rolls, everybody.
Well, it's a coin flip because there's two of you.
Okay,
so obviously I have a coin. This coin has done a lot for me during Cyberpunk. Also, this fucking quarter for the state of
characters and who's dying today.
Never mind. It's just the arches. It's one of the landmark ones. We're gonna flip to see who we start with. So who?
I also have a good start. I need to whisper to you about how, where I was in the dream, how it can tie into the story.
Okay, so call it heads or tails.
Tails.
Okay.
That's fair. I called the last coin flip.
Yeah. Tails. So we're starting with Luke.
Okay.
And I was in a tavern. He was in an office, right?
Whose car is first? Luke!
Yeah! Yeah.
Luke's car!
All the characters in that car need to die, not me.
So yeah, so we'll start with me, and I'm just in a tavern.
And I'm in the office. I have a good idea of why a bard's in the office.
But you fucking...
I was putting you in places based on your Cyberpunk character.
I mean, I can just tell you right now, this is not, like, far off.
Okay.
I was thinking that I'd be like in a permit office or like waiting.
Yeah, like a street performer.
Yeah, like God, like I fell asleep waiting for like to get a performing permit in a new set town.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
Yeah, that's all I was thinking.
I like that.
Yeah, I'm very interested in getting this because some of my favorite.
I gotta like remember to mix this a little bit, like with those harder,
because like it settles and shit, and yeah.
Dude, the last sip of the Voodoo Ranger
is like the
crap, dude, that thing's
that hits you.
It's heavy.
This shit goes down you. Yeah, and you feel ill. You're like, what the fuck?
This is not what I was drinking.
All alcohol.
That like kicks you in the ass. Be like, oh, I need another one to wash that down.
Yeah.
Yeah. The first sip is like, this is just tea.
And then the last sip is, oh boy, I need more tea. Damn.
Sorry, I burped.
No, but I'm beyond excited for this. I've been like just fiending.
I skipped lunch.
Yeah.
I ate like shit, probably like 5 minutes, but I didn't take my hour long lunch. And I was like, because Jake was also like, hey, we're going out of town for 3 days in Panama City, Florida, and we're gonna leave on a Sunday and we'll get back on a Wednesday. And I was like, all right, well, I gotta figure some stuff out. Also, I hate going out of town. Also, it means I'm going to be missing, like, a Tuesday.
Yeah.
So I'm like, and Jake was gone, so I was like, I'm skipping lunch, and I'm dipping. Like, I got things to do.
Skipping and dipping.
Dude, I got the thing that I look forward to every week today.
Damn. So
catch me, you know, you won't catch me being here another hour if I have to.
3 days of the Florida flicks.
I was like,
no, dude, I, like, seriously, unless we don't work, I hate out of town trips, because there's been two out of town trips where, like, for like once the first two, 3 days, doors weren't delivered, nothing was delivered, or hardware was delivered on the first one, and doors weren't, so we couldn't do anything. So me and Jake just sat in this coffee shop called Iron Bank, like, coffee house that was like an old bank, and like you could sit in the actual like locked bank vault. They had like chairs there. That was pretty cool. I beat Luigi's Mansion at least like 80% of it when it first came out. And then the second time was Mobile, Alabama, where the whole week nothing got delivered.
That's Mobile, Alabama for you.
And we went out to get nice seafood. We did a day trip to New Orleans. I got to see Jacqueline. Like, we had beignets every day. Hell so yeah. It was like, and then the next time that he had to go back out, I just was like, no, I'm not gonna, like, I'll do work here in Tennessee. So those have been the only two good work trips.
Damn.
All the rest, I don't play. I don't have fun. I just go, like, I'm going back to the hotel room and watching YouTube videos.
Yeah.
Until we have to go to dinner, and then I'm going to bed. So.
Ezra needs to just fucking text me every once in a while. Just for the audience's benefit, he sent a Instagram DM to Matt the other day and just said, send to BJ, as if he doesn't have 9 different ways of contacting me. So thanks for that, buddy.
That is funny of just like, yeah, send this one to BJ. Like, he can't reach out to you.
Yeah, like, you couldn't take the 2 extra seconds to search BJ. He
also was pretty bothered the fact that we didn't come to K-Barbecue. Which, again, it's like, it's dope that we have now, like, a new group of friends that we all, like, now after the party, we all, like, vibe with.
Yeah, now that the beef is squashed.
Yeah. And, because he was like, dude, you should have, all 3 of you should have been at KBBQ. And I was like, dude, like, all of us, like, you were working, and I had a date night with Cartman. So I was like, none of us can come.
If it had been the very next day, we could have gone.
I know.
At least we could've.
Didn't he put it in the Discord? Is that where it was like?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. To be fair, like,
that was another thing that pissed me off on 4th of July. Because I was sitting out there, and I was getting all your texts about, whoa, everything about life is so crazy. And then Ezra sent a text in the Discord that was like, if y'all aren't busy, come by the river house. And I was like, I fucking would.
But anyways, we need to link up with them.
Yeah.
I'm thinking, Carmen asked me, cause my next birthday is my 30th. Obviously going
to do 30.
A party, but I thought like maybe a theme would be fun. But mostly it's like, I just want to like be outside every birthday. It's get a little bonfire, play some games and get drunk.
Yeah.
Like that is such a good time for me. But I was thinking like, it might be kind of fun getting the people that went on the kayak trip and, well, just everyone from Discord and be like, we could camp out in the backyard.
That'd be dope.
And actually, then, though.
Right?
Because everyone though, would
be
yeah.
there. We'd all go to bed at like 3 in the morning. In the morning, I'd make dinner for everybody. And the other one was like, maybe we could also hit the Duck River.
Yeah.
Which is right there.
That's a much quicker trip.
So it's like Duck River, maybe in the day, and then in the evening, camp out at
Matt's house. That sounds awesome.
Yeah, right? I was like, it doesn't have to be like a big thing, because like there is one thing that I was thinking in October. Sturgill Simpson, who's like one of my favorite artists, is playing in Nashville, and I would love to see him, but if not, doesn't happen. Because like what I've kind of liked with like venues and concert like events is like the fact that I don't have to, if like $50, maybe $60 or like $70 is kind of like the most I really want to spend.
Yeah.
And then like if it's close.
Yeah, I mean the best time, some of the best times we've ever had are just small, like weird venues out of the way. Dungeons and Daddies in the Caverns. And then
fucking right down the
Earth, Wind and Fire.
9 minutes down the road. Yeah. It's like if there was a you know, I'd maybe pay more for like an artist I really liked. But that's the hard thing about like living in, a lot of times when like I catch up with people that I don't really talk to, they're like, oh, like you're in Nashville, like you must like see so many concerts. And I'm like, the hard thing about concerts is it can be as little as twice the cost of a movie ticket or as much as like 10 times the cost of a movie ticket. And it's an artist that I only like 3 songs of.
I will say the one that me and my sister went to, Mystery Skulls, was in just like a little bar. in Nashville. VIP tickets were like $25, and that was a great time.
I mean, yeah, like, but that's the thing. It's like most of the times I don't go see concerts because it's not somebody that I.
Yeah, it's like somebody that you know one song of or know peripherally.
Yeah, exactly. And that's like Earth, Wind, and Fire was like the exception. $35 yeah. tickets, 9 minutes down the road, and I knew every
And it's
song.
All bangers.
And I know
all
every.
All bangers.
I grew up on that kind of stuff. So it's.
That was still one of the best concert like things ever.
I mean, like so I grew good. Up going to like stuff with my parents. Yeah. And so I think there's only been like. I mean, I snuck into Coachella one year. I mean, this
fuck
was,
yeah, dude.
Yeah, I mean, it was right in the beginning where people were like doing it. Well, it was like, you know, the age of social media, because like then you'd see videos of people like sneaking in, and it was like, oh yeah, like this is how you get it. And then it just shit got cracked
before
down.
They got like hella viral and shit.
Yeah. And so it was that during that time where like
razor wire fences and shit.
Where like, I mean, people sneak into venues, big concert venues, all the time. Like, that's something since the, you know,
since the beginning of concerts.
Yes, exactly. And so that's nothing new. And so there was one year, friends and I, they were like, hey, we're doing this. Got to see Cage the Elephant and...
that's a good one.
What's the other one? It's the instrumental band. Explosions in the Sky. Mm. Oh, Explosions in the Sky was crazy. But it was just like 2 days that we were there, slept in the passenger seat of a car in the parking lot. And then that was it. Like, Carmen didn't even know. Like, we were dating at the time, but it was more of those things. I was like, I'm just going to run away and go do this on the weekend and then come back. And it was fine. But I, like, saw Switchfoot when I was in college. They played at my school, which was,
that's
again,
dope.
It was. And I loved Switchfoot, and I still think they fucking...
They rule.
They rock, dude. Yeah. And, but it was really fun. I still think Earth, Wind, Fire was the best concert I've ever seen. I mean, there were so many things. It was a great venue. We had great seats. And there's something, like, obviously the songs, and I mean, they sounded amazing.
Yeah, they sounded like one-to-one live.
And yeah, phenomenal live. Like, everything about it was perfect. And then on top of that, which is something that, like, I'd never really gauged on previous concerts, was the vibes of everyone around you.
Yeah, I mean, everybody was up dancing.
Everyone was up dancing, and everyone was, like, joyful, even though it's, like... You could say, like, of course everyone at a concert is having a good time, but, like, there was something different about Earth, Wind, Fire.
Yeah, there's a difference between people are getting their teeth knocked out in a mosh pit and everybody's just vibing to Earth, Wind, and Fire.
And especially when, like, definitely it's an older demographic, and a lot of it were, like, you know, like, people of color and black people, and I loved... There's something about it that I just was, like, loved it. It felt really... It was a great con.
It was genuine. It felt very hippie and lovey. And
yeah.
It was one of those things where, like, I've been to, you know, like, obviously, like, growing up in church, I went to, like, Winter Jam.
Yeah.
And stuff like that. So I've seen, like, a bunch of big, like, Christian artists.
But Christian artists fucking suck.
A lot of them do.
Every Christian rock artist should kill themselves.
The best Christian...
If I ever go to a concert again and you stop in the middle of a fucking song to say, everybody raise your hands up right now. We're going to pray right now. I'll fucking kill you on sight. Continue.
Anyway, the probably two best Christian like artists I've seen live have been like Skillet and Toby Mac.
Oh, Skillet would be fun to see.
Yeah. I saw Skillet live.
Skillet
and Gunger.
Oh, nice.
It was what's so weird is I thought I'd never been to Tennessee before, and then this flashback happened where in high school and junior high, we had like a Presbyterian conference. For like youth conference, and it was in Tennessee. I just never knew.
Just your brain didn't like.
I just didn't compute. I was like, oh, we're all getting on the plane. We're going there. We're staying at the dorms of some college, and we're gonna go see, you know, 15 bands and like some, you know, popular young adult Christian speakers.
Yeah,
and that's all I remember. But I was like Skillet, Gunger, and then not to, anyways, yeah. And then turns out then like years later, my mom like is. One of the woman who plays is like one of the leads in Gunger. Her their child has Down syndrome, and then is like,
nice. And then it just goes back to Nancy knows fucking everybody.
Yeah. It's so weird.
I have like this sneaking suspicion that if I introduced your mom to my mom, your mom would already know my mom.
just
it's
like
one of those things that there's that like joke of like, oh, you know, this person knows everything, and they finally go to the Vatican, and the person
waiting
who's outside.
That guy up there with Paul?
Yeah, who's that? That's the Pope. So, but I'm also stoked for D&D. It is definitely something I'm more familiar with.
Yeah, I've been asking a lot of questions, obviously, because D&D Beyond is a fucking way more of a nightmare to me than I thought it would be. Just because I don't have the fucking books that make it so much easier.
You should probably do, and we can do it here, is get a printout of your thing, because if we're rolling physically, because the problem is, well, the good thing about D&D Beyond is you say like what type of roll it is, and it adds all your bonuses, but like. Let's say if you're rolling physically, you're like, oh, fuck, I forgot that I have Jack of all trades as a bard. So that gives me proficiency in this. And so it's like I have to remember to add that to my roll. So having.
Well, you guys can roll on Beyond if you want to. I just need to physically roll.
No, that's fine. I know you want to. I'm just saying have a printout so you can see your pluses.
I'm going to. Well, because like I was looking at this thing and I'm probably going to, if we can before we start, like, yeah, can I just print out some shit? Whatever. Yeah,
that's what I was saying. Like, let's
and
do that.
Yeah, do that. So I'll have both D&D and that. And then on the physical one, I can like start writing in like, oh, actually, I want this.
And
spell
in D&D
or
Beyond,
yeah.
Just track your hit points.
Hit points and way. Like, and who knows? Maybe I will roll for some stuff on there just for like, unless like if you tell me like you just roll straight 20 or just do this like whatever.
But then that's like, the thing. It's never straight.
I know, but you know what I mean. It's like
with D&D, it's you have. I mean, so with Bard, I have Jack of all trades, which means that like. Even in stuff that I'm not proficient in, I still get like
a bonus. Of
yeah,
some sort.
A bonus.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's. I have, I think, 5 proficiencies.
Jesus, damn. BG's over here, just like fuck. Damn it, I got to deal with 2 charismatic motherfuckers.
Well, yep. But only one of them is going to be used for actual role play. Everything else is like, I did purposely. I was like, all right. BJ is okay if I don't take any healing spells, and he's like, "I got you." And I was like, "Okay."
That was a thing where I'm like, because when we were figuring out our characters, that there was the thing of like, okay, well, which one of us is gonna like heal? Like,
and I was like, yeah. "I'd be fine playing paladin."
And like,
then BJ was like, "But that's just H," and I was like, "Fuck!"
I would
be different.
Because whenever we first started coming up with the characters, I was like, I'm either gonna do. Because the idea of being the half-drow was what I want to do regardless, like, from the get. And so I was like, okay, well, I'm either going to do the warlock or bloodhunter bit where it's like, oh, yeah, I did something bad to get power as the reason. Or I was like, I could just do paladin because I was going to do one or the other. And I'm like, I kind of like the warlock a bit more. And especially with what we've decided, I'm very much glad I picked the warlock.
Yeah, I'm excited to roleplay this.
that, especially when you're saying, like, oh, yeah. Could be anybody. I'm fucking so excited for that shit, dude. Yeah. without heavily spoiling, like, I want the like the bit to just be like the chipper boss and just the, like overworked like part timer just like I don't know, like that's the vibe in my head. I'm like, yeah, okay, when you need it done by, like,
yeah.
All right. But yeah, I'm excited for D&D, and then I'm also excited just you know, we say this all the time, like, just whenever, like, excited for these Tuesdays, bro. Like, honestly. Because, like, yeah, like, it was like, how's your week been? Fucking sucks. Work sucks. All this. Like, this day, like, helps immensely. Because, yeah. Yeah, fucking, especially my schedule got shifted. So I'm, like, opening a lot more where I'm, like, have to be at work by, like, 8 in the morning instead of, like, 10:45. And so I'm just like, fuck.
That blows.
Not a fan of waking up at 7.
Yeah.
But, yeah. That.
I've been thinking of telling my work that I just can't work weekends and just putting a black square on there. So I just have 3 specific days that I can work a week. Because that's what I'm doing right now. They just shifted around.
Hmm.
Yeah.
So you're only working 3 days a week and you just want to move it to like Monday, Wednesday, Thursday?
Yeah, because 3 days a week gets me everything that I need.
Yeah, I mean, say, go for it. Say, yeah, you can have a weekend off and just do whatever.
Yeah, fuck around, find out.
Maybe we can finally do that MTech video.
Maybe. We'll see.
We literally planned on doing it last weekend.
We're like, we're going to do it on Sunday. And I was Sunday like, came hold- and we both just didn't even mention it.
Yeah. I was like, PJ, hold me accountable.
And neither of you guys were like, no.
I was like, I will.
Here's the other thing that I didn't realize, though. Technically, we don't have to do a video. Like, this is MTech 2024.
But I like it.
I agree. But technically, only thing we have to do is put out our interviews.
Yeah.
Like, technically, that's all we have to do.
That's all we're obligated to do for the, yeah.
Well, that's, like it's like, oh, we're, like, media, so let's cover the people, the things there. I mean, that's exactly what, like, AwesomeCast does.
I think what we should do is, like, do the skit, obviously.
And especially,
I do
here's
not
the
want
other thing. If
cut.
Next year we get, like, another camera, and we do multicams and we edit the fuck out of it. Like, John and Basil would fucking love that.
Yeah.
I mean, already they're getting video this year, which they haven't gotten previous years. So
yeah, I can't wait for them to watch the Tiana Camacho interview back.
Yeah, I'd love to just get them on Discord and be like, hey guys, even though they're check this shit out. They're really kind people that are like, not us.
John was not as perturbed by that situation as we were, I don't think.
No.
But I think Basil would be like, that's weird.
I feel like, well, John's also, I feel like, because he's been like interviewing for so long, he probably just rolls with punches and kind of like, I'll work with it, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then, you know, he was just like, hey, because I guarantee you if we ask him, like, have you had weirder interviews, he probably would have been like, oh yeah, like this thing, then whatever, you know what I mean? Because like, he definitely seems like he knows what he's fucking doing. So I'm like, all right, yeah.
We should just
It also makes me think, like, I could be a voice actor, like, right now.
Yeah.
Seeing that interview.
It's the same thing, like, you were saying with, like, the Sexy Red. She'd be like, dude, I could be a rapper.
Yeah, I could be Sexy Red in a week.
Like, yeah, we could, like, you see the one person getting super popular for, like, the barest bones work. You're like, I could do it.
Also, I could be really successful if I did, like, a hella gay rap album. That would hit TikTok and people would go crazy.
I mean, yeah, there's the, like, the, what's the, boom, boom.
I'm a fucking homosexual.
Yeah. You know what I'm talking about. Yeah.
You've seen that?
I've seen the Guitar Hero one where he, like, it's Guitar Hero, but people, like, chat and pick random songs that they're, and they pick that song.
Dicko mode.
Yeah, but he thinks it's normal sicko mode, and so he starts playing it, and he's, like, hitting it, and then all of a sudden it's, like, sucking his dick, and they're, like, the guy's, like, the fuck?
They can't really stop the Guitar Hero bit. He's like, no, I gotta get the high score. Like, fuck, yeah. Wait, oh.
I love the part where he's like hitting the, like, it's a bridge that goes up and down. He's just like, so funny.
I'm excited for D&D. I'm excited.
That's gonna be you as a bard.
What?
Just that song.
Playing the lute and just looking at everybody for just like mm-hmm.
The crowd is very uncomfortable, but they're turned on.
Yeah.
That, he hits a nat 20 on a crit check.
I do need to whisper some stuff about my backstory that I figured out though.
Okay, we'll do that after this.
Yeah, for sure.
Whisper it, text it to him, just be like, here's the notes, put this somewhere. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, what I don't need to get like too technical, but like how do you format your DM screen? Like, you have like,
I mean, there's nothing in there right now.
Oh yeah,
because it's all just on my iPad. But on the one that I have now,
do you have Cyberpunk, the monster manual?
I think so. That's the one that comes free.
I think so.
Yeah. So I have like the basic monsters and stuff. But
it shouldn't be too hard to also like.
Yeah, I mean, for monsters, I can just print out a sheet or just look it up online. But
you can just look up shit.
Yeah. But on the Cyberpunk one, I just have you guys' character sheets on one panel. One panel is this thing that I came up with. Well, I didn't come up with it. I just completely stole it, but it's a good idea to use it. But it's like encounter table almost for making enemies in Cyberpunk. And then the last one is just a map of Night City.
Cool.
Don't forget
to use that. I mean, I don't know if we'll need it now, but that that website that helps do difficulty level for like your party.
Yeah, I'm gonna use a lot of that coming up. I think the only fight we might get into tonight is gonna be like a one-on-one kind of thing.
Cool.
So we won't really.
I was gonna say yeah too. Like how for like this stuff, like are you gonna do kind of like the this enemy has like an encounter rating of this, and so a party of this level will have like a decent challenge, but can still beat it. Or are you gonna like?
Well, that's what the website is.
Yeah. Oh, that's okay.
So
it literally is like I want to create like.
Like, my party's all level 10s. What's a good
enemy for level 10? And not just that. You put in, like, the level of each person, and then it's, like, this is either, like, doable, not doable. It really is, like, super hyper-specific because, like, let's say you're, like, a party of a bunch of, like, magic-using people, and then you're up against, like, physical attack damage people, and you're like, oh, fuck.
Yeah.
Like, that's different than me going up against, like, another magic user, which is a lot easier. So it's just, it's all different.
Yeah, different strokes.
Just ready to
but, see. Like, a magic user is also really good against other magic users because they can silence and do all that. But then, like, yeah. So it's just, it's all very dependent on that kind of stuff, so.
Yeah, definitely. Well, thanks for listening. Check out Dubby. They sell energy drinks, and they are pretty good. And if you use our coupon code on checkout, take it sleazy, you'll get 10% off your order. And yeah, go drink that shit. Give us some money. Leave more comments. We really appreciated that.
Yeah, that made my day.
Yeah, and I'm sure it made Luke's.
I honestly, less so of the glazing, more just like, oh fuck yeah, there's another Dragon Age 2 fan in the wild.
Also, what's really interesting about that is it's like 45 minutes in that we talk about that.
Yeah.
So that, to me,
and we don't know who this is, also.
Which is great, because that means they sat and watched our podcast, and we're like, got to a point like, oh, fuck yeah, he's talking about Dragon Age, yeah.
Because here, I mean, personally, I would sooner subscribe to a like, channel than I would comment.
Yeah. To be fair, I'm like, the worst person for that, because, like, you hear all these people be like, yeah, comment on stuff. I fucking never comment on shit.
Like, maybe ever. A like, if I'm, like, really passionate about what they're trying to do. But it's usually only stuff like... Like, if it's, I won't like a normal video. If they're like, this is us, like, I'm trying to, like, we're doing this, and this is what we're about right now, or it's like, oh shit, you know, it's me, Markiplier, and my mom's going through cancer.
I'm in the hospital again.
Yeah, I'm like, okay, fuck it. Yeah, I'll give you a like. Let's get you some money, bud. Yeah. Like shit like that, I'll do, but I rarely.
Even for that, like, my liked videos are just shit that I'm like, I just want to be able to find this again.
100%.
Like, that's my liked videos. Just definitely. Like, I don't know.
This most is, like, of the time, anytime it's like a like for, like, it's either, like, you know, like, it, not for justice, but, you know, it's like a like for, like, I'll leave, if it's not stuff I want to see again, I'll give a like to, like, be like, yeah, like, I support this.
Right.
Yeah. But other than that.
Yeah, I saw you left a like on that Trump shooter manifesto video. I've been meaning to talk to you about that.
Dude, crazy shit's been going on in this country. We were like an inch away.
Yep.
From
world peace.
Yeah. But, you know, if
that's always how life is, though.
You know,
always an inch
I mean,
away.
That's what's so good about this podcast. You're trying to get away from all the dumb shit we see online every day.
Yeah, come listen to our dumb shit.
Yeah, I mean.
Yeah, listen to us talk about dumb shit.
Because even when I try, like. I mean, I'll just, before we cut off, but like a lot of times, like, I used to be in a phase where I was like, let me, like, listen to current events and be, like, up to date with the world.
Always a bad move.
And then I'd hear, like, I would listen to both sides of the aisle. Like, I'd listen to NPR one day, and I'd listen to some other, like, conservative stuff, like, the other day. And then like, after a week, I'm like, I want to kill myself.
Yeah, like...
Like, it doesn't matter what side of the aisle I listen to. I just want to kill myself.
Dave Chappelle was really correct when he said the most traumatic thing that happened to him as a kid was when they watched the Challenger blow up on the TV. And he said, for our generation, the Challenger blows up every fucking day.
Yeah. Yeah, it's crazy. So, if you want to get away from that, give us a like, a subscribe. Fuck it. Comment.
Yo, give us more comments. Like, glaze Matt a little bit. Tell BJ that he, like, that
you're yeah, sexy as hell. Tell me I'm pretty for once. God damn.
Like, just even honestly, even as a comment disagreeing and calling us cucks, just leave the comment so we can roast you.
If you want to call us faggots, that's fine. Just leave it as a comment.
BJ just gave all of you the pass.
And with that,
for once, you get to use it once. Take it sleazy.